Hi everyone. If you're watching the videos in the order that I put them on YouTube, now would be a good time to have a mid-unit review. I'll also remind you of some concepts from the previous unit, Unit 6, particularly free energy and spontaneity. And I just want to take this opportunity to clarify some terminology, such as what do we mean by which side is favored? Okay, first thing is let's remind ourselves of the main delta G equation and make sure that we are positive of what kinds of information we can gather from it. Delta G equals delta H minus T delta S. If delta G is negative, and I usually put it like that, or you could say less than zero, that means that the reaction in which it's written in the forward direction is spontaneous. So you'll be doing calculations where you'll be given or solving for delta H and delta S, and then deciding whether the reaction is spontaneous or not based on the sign of delta G. Usually, delta G is in kilojoules per mole. So just make sure that your units agree, especially if they give entropy as joules per mole dot K. Okay. Let's pretend we have a reaction. We'll keep this in mind for part A. Part B, let's have a general reaction 2A plus B goes to C. So in this case, we are solving for the equilibrium expression, KC. Or the equilibrium constant, KC. If we have that reaction that I described, 2A plus B in equilibrium with the product C, then you should know that the expression is KC equals concentration of the products over reactants. But make sure that you use the coefficient as the exponent. Now, don't forget that for the expression, only use gaseous and aqueous components. I can't begin to tell you how many times I was scratching my head that the answer didn't make sense because I was using solid and liquid. So don't use solid and liquid, use only gaseous and aqueous. Okay, when you have KC, that means that the reaction is at equilibrium, or we call it dynamic equilibrium, to be a little more specific. And what that means is that the rate of the forward direction, FWD equals the rate in the reverse direction. And even though we are continually making C and continually making A and B, the concentrations stay constant. So there is no net concentration change, even though the reactions are still happening. It is dynamic. Now, the other thing I want to mention about this is that KC is temperature dependent. What color am I using? Let's put a couple of notes here. KC is temperature dependent. The other thing I want to mention is that some textbooks use the term KEQ. If your textbook uses the term KEQ, that's just the same. We're gonna assume that it's the equilibrium constant using concentrations, unless otherwise told differently. Now, this is where I want to add some clarification to the terminology. If KC is greater than 1, well, that means that their numerator is larger than the denominator. And in general, products are favored when you have this situation. You could say products are favored at equilibrium. We're using K, so it's defined as the situation at equilibrium. Now, if we have the opposite, KC is less than 1, then products, sorry, reactants are favored. It is telling you that the rate of the reverse is larger than the rate of the forward? Not at all. Because at equilibrium, this is always true. What this is telling you is that the denominator is bigger. The reactants concentrations in general are higher at equilibrium. Now I keep saying in general because it's kind of hard to make a broad statement because we don't know the exponents. They're different for different reactions. But in general, yeah, the numerator you could say is bigger or the denominator is bigger. And you could figure out or you can state that one of the sides is favored, either the products or the reactants. Okay, that's what I want to say about the equilibrium constant KC. Next, for part C, let's talk about a little more about the reaction quotient, QC, and what kind of conclusions we could draw from QC. QC is a reaction quotient. QC. And if we use the same reaction as we did, chemical interaction as we did up here, it's literally the same expression. Okay. QC equals concentration of C divided by concentration of A. This reaction is squared and B. Okay. It's squared because we have a coefficient of 2 for our chemical reaction. You use the letter Q if you don't know if you don't know if you're at equilibrium or not. If you don't know if at equilibrium, or if you do know that you're off equilibrium, or if you do know it is off equilibrium, that the QC calculated does not equal KC. All right, so there are information, there's information from whether QC is larger or less than KC. Before we go to that, let me just say that really the goal of every reaction is to get equilibrium, just to be at equilibrium. The goal of every reaction, or the driving force for every reaction is to get to equilibrium. And in that case, yes, in those conditions at equilibrium, QC is equal to KC. Okay. But what's interesting about the Q, the reaction quotient, is what information we could get if they're not equal, if it's greater than or less than KC. We can definitely make some important conclusions in either case. So the first case, let's say QC is greater than KC. What that means is that QC is too big. And what is too big in the expression? There's too much products. Too much products? And we're off equilibrium. Okay? We're off equilibrium. So what's going to happen is, and this is important, to get back to equilibrium, we have to reduce the products and increase the reactants. Let me put that in blue. To get back to, or e to get to equilibrium, we have to reduce the concentration of the products, and when you do that, when you have less products, that's because you're consuming the products to make more reactants. So these two go hand in hand. The concentration of the products going down, which will result in the concentration of the reactants going up. Now, how do you do that? The equilibrium temporarily shifts. And how does it shift? It shifts to the left. It shifts to the reactants because we got to consume some of the products. So that is the conclusion. When you have case QC greater than KC, your conclusion is, you could say the terminology is equilibrium shifts left towards the products. Oh, no, towards the reactants. So temporarily, again, I want to use the word temporarily, the rate of the reverse is greater than the rate of the forward. You may get a problem. I know for a fact that there are some online problems that my class has where they ask, if I perturb the equilibrium based on QC, which one is larger, or are the rates equal? Now, the rate of the reverse is going to be greater than the rate of forward until what? Until we get to KC. Until QC equals KC. And then you're back. You're back to the rate equals forward of the rate forward equals the rate of the reverse. Can we do the opposite? QC is less than KC. That means QC is, whoops, QC is too small. Right, too small, and we got to make QC bigger to get it to be equal to KC. QC is too small. Well, if QC is too small, to get it larger, we got to increase the numerator and decrease the denominator to get QC to increase. So here we have too little products. The numerator is too small. So I'm just going to skip to here. We're going to say our conclusion is equilibrium. Let me underline this. Left towards reactants for our first situation. Here, equilibrium shifts right towards products. A lot of students do memorize these phrases, depending on QC, but under the stress of an exam, you may forget what goes with what. You just have to think it through. If QC is too small, you gotta make more of the numerator to get QC ultimately to get bigger. So it shifts to the right towards the products, and temporarily, what happens? The rate of the forward to make the products is larger than the rate of the reverse. And that again happens or is true until QC equals KC. I believe that's all I want to say for this mid-unit review. We got topics A, B, and C.